Penguin Random House Audio presents The End of Race Politics: Arguments for a Colorblind America. This is the author, Coleman Hughes. Note to listeners, this program contains a downloadable bonus PDF of key graphs, charts, and other visual aids from the book. For Santa Cruz Hughes, whose light was extinguished far too soon. Introduction. Why write about race? I've always found race boring. Sure, it can be good source material for jokes at a comedy club, but in most real-life situations, a person's race tells you next to nothing about them. It doesn't tell you whether they're kind or selfish, whether their opinions are right or wrong, whether they'll become your best friend or your worst enemy. Of all the qualities you could list about somebody, their personality, beliefs, sense of humor, and so forth, their race is just about the least interesting you could name. So if I find race to be a meaningless trait, why write a whole book about it? The answer is simple. I didn't choose the topic of race. It chose me. I'm what you'd call half black, half Hispanic, or simply black. We'll see in a chapter how these categories can change depending on time and place. For most of my young life, I rarely thought about my racial identity. I had black friends, white friends, Asian friends, Hispanic friends, and mixed race friends. But I didn't think of them as black, white, Hispanic, and mixed race. I thought of them as Rodney, Stephen, Javier, and Jordan. For the most part, the people I grew up around seemed to share my lack of interest in race. They agreed with Martin Luther King Jr.'s famous dictum about the content of one's character trumping the color of one's skin, even if collective overuse has already made it a cliché. On the rare occasion that some petty person did try to use race as a weapon, to bully someone, for instance, the dominant value system would come down on them like a tornado. They would be ostracized and punished. Where I grew up in Montclair, New Jersey, racists existed, but they were exceedingly rare exceptions that proved the overwhelming rule. Montclair's well-loved public schools were my home until the sixth grade, when I enrolled at a fancy private school several towns away. Though the education I received at this new school was undoubtedly better, the social transition was awkward. The main locus of this awkwardness was my large, voluminous afro. In my hometown public school, where around 1 in 3 students were black, afros were commonplace. Kids of every race were used to seeing them. But at Newark Academy, I was a novelty. There were only 4 black students in the entering class of over 60 kids, and most of the non-black students did not come from racially diverse towns like Montclair. Many of them had never known somebody with an afro. What began as an understandable curiosity about my hairstyle grew into a ubiquitous and apparently irresistible urge to touch it, usually ruining whatever preparation I had done that morning to get it looking just right. I hoped this was just a passing curiosity. But as the weeks turned into months, it became clear that the urge to touch my hair was insatiable. To make matters worse, no single person pestered me enough to be singled out. The blame was distributed among so many kids that it could not be solved by talking to any one of them. Death by 1,000 cuts. Eventually, I broke down, thoroughly frustrated with my peers, and ashamed that I had let the problem grow to such proportions. I cried hot tears to my parents. I was tired of having my hair ruined by my classmates' curiosity, tired of being treated like a novelty act. I don't remember whether the problem stopped after my parents talked to the school principal, but what I do remember is that by 7th grade, the afro was gone, replaced by an unassuming fade. In retrospect, a way better choice anyway. 4 years later, when I was 16, the higher-ups at Newark Academy offered me the chance to attend a 3-day event in Houston called the People of Color Conference. I said yes, jumping at the opportunity to miss 3 days of class. Misleadingly, The conference was not just for people of color, but for private school students of all races, hundreds of us from around the nation. Though I wouldn't have known to call it this at the time, the conference was essentially a 3-day critical race theory and intersectionality workshop. It was there that I first heard terms like systemic racism, safe space, white privilege, and internalized oppression. Ideas that were fringe in 2012, but would sweep through the elite universities just a few years later. Up until 2012, I had never been immersed in a subculture where my race was considered to be important. The People of Color Conference changed that. At the conference, my blackness was not considered a neutral fact, irrelevant to my deeper qualities as a human being. My blackness was instead considered a kind of magic. My skin color was discussed as if it were a beautiful enigma at the core of my identity, a slice of God inside my soul. The conference leaders taught us one idea that pertained directly to my unfortunate Afro experience from middle school, a microaggression. A microaggression, I learned, was a statement or action that conveys subtle, unintentional discrimination against members of a marginalized group. Before learning this term, I had filed the Afro fiasco under the heading of difficult experiences that many kids face in middle school. In fact, I recall thinking that it was not nearly as bad as the verbal abuse experienced by my white friend for being an unlucky mix of pale, skinny, nerdy, and awkward. Bullying that eventually prompted him to leave the school. Nor was it anywhere close to the mocking endured by the overweight, pimply white kid whose manner of speech seemed to be permanently slurred. In truth, it wasn't even bullying. The kids touching my afro were never malicious, only curious. They never teased me or insulted me, and I easily got along with them in every other context. As annoying as their behavior was, the obvious goodwill behind their actions softened my judgment of them. At the conference, however, I was taught to frame my experience differently. It was a microaggression. Whereas bullying can be experienced by anyone, only members of marginalized groups can experience microaggressions. My Afro experience was placed on the same continuum as the violent racism I had learned about in history class. At one end of that continuum was Emmett Till and the brave civil rights protesters beaten at Selma. And on the less severe end of that same continuum was me. I had experienced a microdose of the same poison. I was taught that my victimization was special, and that made me special. Where my white friends had the wind of white supremacy at their backs, I faced a headwind, and everything I had accomplished in spite of it was that much more impressive as a result. That was the ideology that I, along with hundreds of other students, absorbed at this 3-day conference. The atmosphere, however, was less scholarly than it was spiritual. For instance, many of the students at the conference were gay and came from households that were socially conservative. For some, the conference was the first time in their entire lives that they could voice their sexuality out loud without fear of judgment. There was crying and hugging and warmth. In those ways, the energy in the room was uplifting. But in other ways, it was suffocating. The teachers enforced a strict orthodoxy. Dissent was never welcomed and was therefore rarely even attempted. You could no more challenge the doctrines being taught than you could argue that God doesn't exist from a Sunday morning church pulpit. As a kid who enjoyed debating with professors, I couldn't help but notice and lament the stifling conformism. After my brief foray into the strange, race-obsessed world of the POC conference, I returned to my life as a high school student who cared about music and philosophy and who connected with others on the basis of shared interests rather than race. I never imagined that the subculture I encountered in Houston would appear in my life again. Then I enrolled at Columbia University. In the 3 years since I'd attended the conference, the ideas I encountered there had spread to elite high schools and universities throughout the nation. During orientation week at Columbia, we were asked to divide ourselves up by race and discuss how we either participated in, or suffered from, systemic oppression. I huddled with the black kids in one corner of the room and watched as the white kids, Hispanic kids, and Asian kids awkwardly shuffled to their respective corners. Whatever the intent of this ice-breaking exercise, the effect was that I felt acutely aware of my blackness. And that awareness, ironically...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.